Tashdile, and welcome to In Conversation with Tibet TV. This is Sakina Butt. Today in our studio, we have the wonderful presence of a South African politician who serves as a member of the National Assembly for the Inkhata Freedom Party. He is Mkhuleko Hlengwa. It's lovely to have you here, Mkhuleko. Welcome to our show.
Thank you very much.
So, Mkhuleko, tell us what inspired you to champion the cause of Tibet.
Well, the cause of Tibet is not just isolated. It's a global reality, because wherever an injustice prevails, it prevails for all of us. And therefore, nobody who is in a position of freedom can fully enjoy that freedom, leaving behind his fellow brothers and sisters who live in conditions of oppression. And therefore, the former president of the Inkhata Freedom Party, Prince Mangosuthu Buthelezi, who is now our president emeritus, is a lifelong advocate for the Tibetan issue. And he has passed this issue on to us, the younger generation. And we recognize its worth, because that whatever corner of the world we are in, we stand in solidarity with those who are oppressed. So I consider myself a South African, but also at the same time a friend of Tibet.
How do you lobby for Tibet in a non-Tibetan society? How do you make the issue of Tibet relevant to them?
Well, if you are advocating for the Tibetan issue, then you are, as I indicated, advocating for justice and freedom, particularly in the South African context, where we are coming from colonialism and colonial apartheid. And so we are people who know what it is to be oppressed. We know the difficulty of being a pariah in your own land. And so coming from that kind of background, South Africa should be one of the countries where the issue of Tibet is slam bang in the middle of the agenda. And that is why we take it up. And so whether we're raising it in the Houses of Parliament or in the public discourse, the reality is that we have to raise it, and we can't be confined by political pressure, because the issue of Tibet is not political. It's a matter of principle, and it's a matter of historic context. And if we lose sight of those two things, then we are not worth the salt. So I want to fully emphasize the notion that anybody who approaches this matter from the basis of political correctness, they've already missed it. Here you are dealing with 6-7 million Tibetans who find themselves unable, one, to culturally and traditionally live their lives. They are unable to channel their energies to that which they want, particularly the manipulation and oppression of religious rights and religious freedoms. And therefore, it becomes important that we separate the political injunctions which have become a reality in this matter from the core issue. And the core issue is that of the freedom to choose how you want to live your life. And that is where China has been found wanting. And that's my problem with the South African government, because we are choosing expediency over principle. We are choosing economic prosperity over human rights. And we are choosing ourselves over others, whereas we have known for the longest of time that our own freedom arose out of people choosing us over themselves. And we are duty bound as South Africa to actually repay not just the Tibetan people, Hong Kong, Taiwan, Mongolia. And you look at the issue of global oppression. So in all those realities, you find that the fundamental issue is that those in positions of freedom need to place themselves at the very center of those struggles to make sure that freedom is universally enjoyed. And so that is why I drive home the point that this is a matter of principle. And I think that is why we advocate, and that's why it's not difficult to do so.
Mkhuleko, we were so grateful of the fact that you had raised the issue of Tibet in the chambers of the South African Parliament. You highlighted on the human rights violations that were inflicted on the Tibetans in Tibet by the Chinese government. You even told that Africa should prioritize the human rights and justice before the economic ties with China. So what kind of response do we get from the South African Parliament when you raise a question on the Tibet issue?
If you are dealing with people who have positioned themselves for political correctness, you're not going to get the kind of response that is required and the one which is of urgency given the gravity of the situation on the ground. But that should not stop you, of course, from raising it. The fundamental issue is whether you subscribe to the One China policy or not, you should not, in whatever choice you make, sacrifice human rights. South Africa ought to recognize that if China continues on the trajectory of the violation of human rights, we are complicit in that. We are aiding and abetting a system which at some point in one way or the other had oppressed us. Mm-hmm. Because it's not a matter of who's oppressing, it's a matter of how the oppression is meted out, and the commonalities are very much the same. Secondly, it becomes of critical importance that we do not sell our souls to the devil, for lack of a better term. And the issue is we cannot, in good faith, sit back and allow the situation to deteriorate. So this is less about China and more about the universal principle about, one, nobody should oppress. Most importantly, nobody should be oppressed. Do we want trade? Yes, we do. Is China a trading partner? Yes, it is. But every trade has got an opportunity cost and a trade-off. And every trade has got terms and conditions. What we should not compromise on is trade which adheres, amongst other things, but not limited to, human rights. And that is why this is important. I think His Holiness has come halfway. The middle way approach calls upon China and the international community to meet the Tibetans halfway. And that is the discussion we need to be having at this point in time.
Mkhuleko, I really admire your thought of thinking that in this world nobody should be oppressed. It's not about who is oppressing, but it's about who is being oppressed. I really admire that. And also, can you tell us how difficult it is to raise your voice in favor of the Tibetans?
It's not difficult. It should
you
never
don't,
be difficult.
You don't face any challenges?
Even if you do face the challenge, it can't be difficult. Okay. Because you're not, it's not about yourself. It's about the plight of 6-7 million people in exactly. Tibet and millions around the world mm-hmm. who are living in oppression, who are living in conditions of poverty, who are unable to pursue their collective sustainable livelihoods. Mm-hmm. And on the shoulders of those who are free rests the collective dreams, hopes, and aspirations of those who are oppressed. And therefore, if you find that difficult, then you don't deserve freedom yourself, because freedom should enable you to be free to speak on behalf of those who can't speak. So whatever comes our way, look, it's a drop in the ocean for so long as the voice is heard. Even if we don't achieve the freedom of Tibet in our lifetime, what we must achieve is the sustainability of the cause towards that freedom. And that requires us to be speaking on the daily.
Mkhuleko, you must be aware of the fact that the Chinese students were actually protesting when Sikyong Dr. Lobsang Singhi visited to South Africa. In fact, the president of the Inkhata Freedom Party, Mongosuthu Buthelezi, also condemned this action. This is a very sad incident. So what do you have to say about this?
Look, you know, in South Africa, we're quite free, as I'm saying. And if you want to protest, yeah, protest. But we need to protest for the right reasons. And a protest should seek to achieve an outcome that, one, builds, and secondly, unites people. Now, the protest of these students does not tick any of those boxes. It's a populist, propagandist, narrow-minded, myopic protest designed to advance an agenda which is inconsistent with human rights. So I do want to stand on the side of those who condemn it. I don't think it was necessary, because I think what needs to be recognized by Chinese abroad is that the liberation of Tibet is the liberation of the Chinese people. Because they need to understand that for so long as the heavy hand of China is exerted on Tibet, Taiwan, Hong Kong, and so on, then most likely it will be even firmer on mainland China. And so if we push back on the frontiers of this oppression, on this violation of human rights, we are actually pushing back on it escalating to a higher level even in China. And so I think the students should have been protesting really against the oppression of Tibet and not against those who seek the freedom and liberation of Tibet.
You also know that for the past decade, South Africa has been denying the visa for His Holiness the Dalai Lama to South Africa. So obviously, this is because of the pressure from the Chinese government. So what do you have to say about this?
Well, it's a tragic reality. It's very sad that a free South Africa, which has been oppressed for over 300 years, would allow the perpetuation of an oppression of another people elsewhere through succumbing and buckling to the pressures of an oppressive government and an oppressive regime. We should not have allowed that to happen. It must never manifest itself ever again, where South Africa becomes the exclusive domain of those who enjoy the support of China. Because if that is the case, then South Africa is finding itself in a second era of its own oppression of one way or the other, where we are remote controlled somewhere else. I want to pay a particular tribute to Prince Mangosuthu Buthelezi, because when he was Minister of Home Affairs, he granted the Dalai Lama a visa twice. And when he was out of government and the government denied His Holiness a visa, he took that government to court, because he understood that the issue is about principle and about freedom. And if South Africa is free, it's not just free for South Africans, it's free for everyone, including and particularly the oppressed, which is His Holiness and the Tibetan people, to have a platform to speak about their prevailing realities. And I think the action of Prince Buthelezi in solidarity with His Holiness and the Tibetan people and the oppressed people of the world sent a very strong message to all South Africans and the government in particular, that there are South Africans who will stand on the side of that which is just, on the side of principle, and on the side of our own constitution. And so our relationship with Tibet remains strong, it remains necessary, and it remains part and parcel of the struggle for freedom around the world, which needs to continue into the future. And that's why Prince Buthelezi was instrumental in setting up the Tibetan office in Pretoria, so that you could have a platform outside the normal spaces in which you are speaking about this issue, so that it could gain the kind of international traction that it deserves. And that's a struggle and a cause which needs to continue if we are true to our own convictions and understand where we're coming from, but most importantly, know where we're going.
When you were speaking on the issue of Tibet in the parliament, we were so glad to see you being donned in the Tibetan traditional attire. And you said that the attire was gifted to you when you had visited the birthday of His Holiness the Dalai Lama in South Africa. So, and you said that there is a very special message that the T-shirt reminds you of. So can you share that message with us?
Well, the other message for me is that we need to be proud of our friends. And we need to appreciate their cultures and traditions. And this is part of it, identifying and just being able to open a window, even no matter how small, to the rest of the world of who and what we are talking about. And so it's about putting ourselves in your shoes so that we can be able to advocate for your message. And it's a message to the South African government that there are voices which understand what is going on. And importantly, it's voices which are not saying we are anti-China. That must be firmly understood. What we are against is the oppression of people, the violation of human rights. And so for me, this shirt means more than just an attire. It's the uniform of a soldier in the field who is going out there to advocate for a cause. And I shall continue doing so. And I'm sure that Prince Mangosuthu Buthelezi is going to push us in that direction in the South African discourse to make sure that we are not silenced. So even if we don't speak, our attire says a lot, because it raises a question. What is he wearing? And that triggers the conversation. And by triggering the conversation, we are able to educate, inform, and hope that what we say will be transferred to other people. So there are many ways to advance the message, and the attire is one such. And it makes an emphatic statement of conviction and belief, but also at the same time, standing in solidarity as one. That's why I say I identify as a friend of Tibet.
Mkhuleko, thank you so much for your support for the cause of Tibet and for your wonderful words that you shared with us today. Thank you for being here with us.
It's been an absolute pleasure, and all I can say to Tibetans is that you are not alone in this long and difficult road to freedom, to liberation. We stand shoulder to shoulder with Tibetans. We stand in solidarity with all peace and freedom loving citizens of the world, wherever they may be. But our particular focus at this time is with Tibetans. And I want to just say, stand strong, don't give up. A wise man once said, it is better to travel in hope than to arrive. And it is that hope that carried us in the past, carrying us today, and will most certainly be carrying us tomorrow.
Thank you so much once again.
It's a pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you so much for watching, and see you in the next episode of In Conversation with Tibet TV.